Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and get started, and I'm pretty sure more people will join us. But we want to welcome everyone to the final episode, if you will, of our spring seminar series for 2021. This is our 14th seminar, and we have the privilege of having Dr. Donna Nelson. And one of the backstories I'd like to share is one in which I think I've said before for another speaker. I am pretty sure about, I don't know how many years now, somewhere within 5 to 10 years, I did try to get Dr. Nelson to do a seminar presentation for us. But given that she's a very busy woman, she probably had to turn us down, but I persisted, and she's here with us today, and it's a privilege to have her here. Our introducer today is Jasmarie. She's a senior. Her major is biochem pre-med. She plans to go to med school, become a forensic pathologist. She went to Tacoma Academy. She lives in Bowie, Maryland. Her family is from Jamaica, and she usually goes back every year to see them. She also plays the piano and clarinet. And I will continue to jab at Jasmarie here because she has not yet seen a single episode, a single episode of Breaking Bad. How could that be? Anyway, she will introduce our speaker today.
Okay, so Dr. Donna J. Nelson is our speaker, and she is an American chemist and professor of chemistry at the University of Oklahoma. She earned her Bachelor of Science degree in chemistry at the University of Oklahoma and obtained her chemistry PhD at the University of Texas in Austin with Michael J.S. Dewar, and did postdoctorate work at Purdue University with 1979 chemistry Nobel laureate Herbert C. Brown. Dr. Nelson has focused on five primary topics of research, generally categorized in two areas: scientific research and America's scientific readiness. The former includes mechanistic patterns in alkene addition reactions and single-walled carbon nanotube functionalization and analysis. America's scientific readiness focuses on science education, which includes classroom innovations and correcting organic chemistry textbook inaccuracies, ethnic and gender diversities among highly ranked science departments of research universities, such as the Nelson Diversity Surveys, and improving the presentation of science and images of scientists to the public, such as serving as a science advisor to the AMC television show Breaking Bad, which, as you now know, I have not really seen. Dr. Nelson has written almost 200 research-related publications and has received a number of honors and awards. These include Oklahoma Outstanding Professor Award in 2005, American Association for the Advancement of Science Fellow in 2005, American Chemical Society President in 2016, being named one of the 70 most inspirational women leaders impacting the world. So Dr. Nelson will discuss her experiences with us today while serving as a science advisor to the award-winning AMC television show Breaking Bad. She will discuss ways in which she has participated, how she came to be involved in the show, and her activities as a science advisor. So without further ado, here's Dr. Nelson.
Okay, so Jasmarie, thank you so much for that very nice introduction. And I'd like to say thank you to Desmond for inviting me. And there's a much greater likelihood that I'm able to come when all I have to do is dial in on Zoom rather than spend 10 hours on the airplane. You know, it's much easier to do this. So I'm really thrilled to be with you today. And I'd just like to say, Alvin, thank you so much for bringing so many people. That's really nice. I appreciate that. I wish I was there, you know, to, it looks like you're having a fabulous party. I wish I was there to enjoy it, but I can't be. So yeah, let me see if I can share this screen here. You know, this is always sort of touchy with me because I am not an expert, but I will try. And so here we go.
There you go.
And let me see if this, so there's the slideshow. So it looks okay so far.
It looks good.
So now let's see if the sound works. Watch the show will recognize that little musical, you know, few notes at the beginning, and usually it's a really good sign if that clip works. If the sound on that clip works, it means that the sound on the other clips will work, which is very important to me. Okay. I want it to work, you know.
Okay.
So Jasmine, you shouldn't feel that bad about not having watched any episodes, because there have been times that, many times, that I've spoken to, you know, groups, after dinner groups, et cetera, and they would just literally say, what's Breaking Bad? So, you know, you shouldn't feel bad at all about it. You're not actually that unusual. I've heard worse, that's for sure. So a lot of my talk is going to answer some of the questions that people frequently ask me. And so let's go ahead and get started. Breaking Bad, I'll give you a little bit of background. It's a television drama series created and produced by Ben Gilligan. It was produced by Sony Pictures Television and broadcast on AMC, set and produced in Albuquerque, New Mexico, premiered in 2008, and the final season ended 2013. It revolves around Walter White, played by Bryan Cranston, a struggling high school organic chemistry teacher with many family issues. He's diagnosed with terminal lung cancer, breaks down, turns to a life of crime, producing and selling meth in a desire to secure his family's future. But this is what I have noticed, and I think this is most important. His illegal activities ruin his life and the lives of those closest to him. And you can read far more than you probably will ever want to know on Wikipedia. It has so many websites about Breaking Bad, and I don't think that I have looked at half of them myself. So anyway, how did I get started? So you're familiar with the American Chemical Society, I'm sure, and you're familiar with Chemical and Engineering News, and this exact issue of Chemical and Engineering News, March, it looks like 5th, 2008, had an interview of Vince Gilligan in it. And in that interview, as you'll know, this is at the end of season one. So in that interview, Vince said a number of really interesting things. And, you know, I usually just sort of thumb through Chemical and Engineering News. But I noticed in this story, there were some unusual photographs that you usually don't see in Chemical and Engineering News, such as, you know, a person in a lab apron and underwear in the middle of the desert. And then, you know, alongside a classroom demonstration. That's Vince Gilligan on your right, as you may know, and Walter White in the middle there on your left. And so, as I said, though, what interested me the most was the quote that was given from Vince. And, you know, for decades, even in 2008, for decades, we had already been discussing how could we possibly, when I say we, I mean we chemists inside the American Chemical Society, we were discussing how can we possibly influence Hollywood, because they seem to be portraying us chemists and also scientists and chemistry so horribly. And we thought it was so wrong. They were getting everything wrong. You know, they would show that whenever a person threw baking powder on another person, that they would die, you know, just crazy, crazy things. And so many people had reached out to Hollywood, and Hollywood, the reaction was always sort of, yeah, sure. You know, don't call us, we'll call you if we need you. And so here was Vince saying this. He said, getting the science details correct was important to him. I think he had been sort of an armchair scientist, sort of a science groupie, especially when he was younger. And he said that much scientific information in the show was researched on the internet because the show's budget did not allow for a paid chemistry advisor. And here comes the important part. We welcome constructive comments from a chemically inclined audience. And when I saw that, there were two thoughts in my head. I thought, oh, wow, he specifies constructive comments. I wonder what all comments he's been getting so far. And then I thought, well, you know, this is an invitation. He wants to hear from us, whereas others had always told us no. And so I looked at that and I could see some positive sides. I thought I should reach out to him, and I thought about some benefits, and I realized there were at least three if I was able to be successful. I thought I'd be able to affect how science and scientists are portrayed on television. The producers and writers would learn more about their subjects, that's the scientific community and science generally. And also the public would see correct scientific information, portraying scientists and science correctly in popular culture helps recruit students into the field. Mm-hmm. But then I also worried about the other side. I worried about being affiliated with the show about meth. I thought, oh no, you know, I couldn't do this. I mean, I had always been concerned about being an appropriate role model. And I thought, I just don't know if I want to do that. That could damage how students regard me. And so what I did is I went away and watched every episode that existed at that time. And I remember there were five. Like I said, this is at the end of season one. And I watched all five. And I realized that It didn't glorify drugs or the drug culture. And as a matter of fact, there were all sorts of lessons in there throughout. Every time they did anything wrong, they got punished. And so I thought, well, I'll volunteer. And the way I had to do this, because you know their phone number isn't just posted on the web, I had to go back to the reporter who had written the story. And I said, what do you think about this quote, you know, that they welcome constructive comments? I said, do you think they're serious or do you think they're just saying this to sort of make themselves look good? And she said, I don't know, I hadn't thought anything about it. And so I said, well, you know, I'll volunteer, but I can't get in touch with them. Would you be willing to take my contact information and get back in touch with them and tell them that they have a volunteer? And we'll just see if they're serious about that or not. She said, sure. And so she did. And I was totally shocked that they phoned me the next week. Wow. So they were serious. Vince was serious about this. And so when I was talking to them, it was a little bit of an interesting discussion. And I had in my mind, I kept remembering that they had said, there's no money for a science advisor. So they said, well, you know, they talked to me and they became convinced that I did know some organic chemistry, you know, because I've been teaching organic chemistry my entire career. And so they said, well, you know, you're in Oklahoma. And they said, do you ever make it out here to Burbank? That's where the writers are located. And immediately, like in just half a second, it flashed through my mind. I thought, they said in that magazine, they don't have any money for a science advisor. And so whether I interact with them really is dependent on how I answer this question.
Hmm.
And so remember, it's hanging there. Do you ever make it out to Burbank? And I just said, oh, all the time. And so she said, great. So the next time you come out, why don't you let us know and you can come by the office and visit us? And so I was actually, it turns out, within a couple of months, supposed to go out to San Diego and see Marianne Fox, who was chancellor out there at UC San Diego. And so I rented a car and drove up to Burbank. And of course, you know, I let them know I was coming. And so they were expecting me. And here I am standing outside the directory, you know, and on the bottom floor, and they were on the second floor. And so I was having to go up to the second floor suites to see them. And so I did. And so once I got in, remember, this was at the end of season one. There wasn't much in their offices. The only thing they had on the windows were a bunch on the walls were a bunch of Breaking Bad posters. And you can see those here. And so I had been thinking, oh, you know, I just don't know if I'll get to see anybody. I don't know how this is going to go. You know, they may not really, you know, think that I'm important at all. You know, but this is going to be fabulous. I'm going to try this out. And so Vince came running out of the, it turned out it was the writer's room where all the writers collected to discuss their ideas. And he came running out with his hand held out at me. And he said, I am so glad you could make it. And I had tried to give one of my calling cards, you know, one of my business cards to his secretary, and she just looked at it and she said, nobody uses business cards in Hollywood. She wouldn't even take it. And so I just said, oh, I'm sorry, and put it back in my pocket, you know, because I really wanted to get along. I kept thinking, you know, this has just got to go well. And so I went on into the room where he was, and I thought, oh, well, I'm going to talk with him, you know. And then he said, my writers want to meet with you also. And I said, okay, great. And one by one, they came in and populated the chairs around this huge table. It's a rectangular table. And they wanted to ask me a bunch of questions. So this, I didn't realize it, but it was sort of like an interview. They wanted to know if, you know, I was a weirdo or if they could actually talk to me. And so they sat down and asked me questions. And they asked me things like, what's it like to be a scientist? What type of person becomes a scientist? How does a scientist talk to people? How does a scientist talk to students? How does a scientist talk to students in a lab? And then I realized these people had never met a scientist. They were having to write for a television show about chemists, yet they had never met any. And so they were asking me just the basic, you know, questions. And I tried as hard as I could to answer them. And these were questions, I'll tell you, I'd never been asked before. I was not expecting this. And so, you know, after answering your questions for about, oh, maybe an hour, then they said, hey, you want to go to lunch? And I said, well, sure, you know. And so they took me out to a pub, and here's all their writers. And then you can see me at the end of the table. And to my left, that'll be on your right, that's Vince in the orange shirt. And the other side, that's my son. I took my son with me so that he could meet all these people and participate as well. And so then the rest of the people around that table are writers. And so we sat there and I answered a bunch more of their questions, you know, and we sat there for about, oh, maybe another hour, you know. And then at the end of that meeting, they said, well, would you be able to answer some questions if we sent you questions by email? And I said, oh, absolutely. I'll be happy to. And so that's the way it started. That's the way it got started. And so then, you know, I went back home and I was thinking, well, you know, I don't know if they're even going to need me. I mean, they've done a pretty good job season one without a science advisor. And so I may never hear from them again. You know, I just didn't know what would happen. And everything, it turns out I was quite correct in my assumption. Everything in Hollywood is really loose. You know, the plans are made sort of at the last minute and everything. So I didn't try to pin them down or anything. And so, but they did send me requests by email. And their first request for assistance was for the following classroom scene. Walt teaches a class on alkenes and their nomenclature. Nomenclature of alkenes. And the writers requested guidance on the alkene terminology. And remember, I was thinking, well, they might not really need me because they've done so well. They did manage to look up all this stuff online. And so they sent me a couple of pages that they had written. And when I read their discussion of alkene nomenclature, I thought, nope, they do need me. Because they had mixed up alkenes and alkynes and alkanes. They had it all mixed up. They didn't understand the difference between those classes of molecules. And so I realized also that they just needed a little bit, you know, like a paragraph. So it's sort of like all of alkene nomenclature in a paragraph, right? So I started out, I said, well, there are monoalkenes and there are dialkenes and trialkenes. And sometimes these are called olefins if they only have carbon and hydrogen. And so I had written some stuff like that and sent it back to them. And they said, oh, this is great. Is there anything that Walt might have written on the blackboard before or during the lecture scene? I said, yeah, I can send you some structures. So I sent them the structural drawings and they said, great, we'll send you a picture when it's drawn on the blackboard. So this is what I sent them. And they said, this is perfect. I passed your note along to our set decorators and request that they grab a photo of the set when it works. And at first I thought, what does that mean? And then I figured it out. And so then this is the blackboard scene. So you can see they really did take my advice. And I looked at that and I thought, oh, this is great. Okay, they took my advice.
Monoalkenes, diolefins, trienes, polyenes. I mean, the nomenclature alone is enough to make your head spin.
You can see my draw.
But when you start to feel overwhelmed, and you will, just keep in mind that one element, carbon. Carbon is at the center of it all. There is no life without carbon. Nowhere that we know of in the universe.
And so, you know, that was the first time that I helped them. And so that was, you know, very interesting. And, you know, I took a sort of a minimalistic approach to their changes, except for this one time where everything had to be sort of thrown out and I wrote them a full paragraph. But I wrote them three different paragraphs so that they could have whatever they wanted. And it turned out they sort of combined all those different paragraphs and sent me back something. And I took, like I said, I took a minimalistic approach. So I read through it and I tried to change as few words as possible because I knew that they knew how to write for Hollywood and I didn't. So I always changed as few words as possible. I felt like I had entered a different community throughout my interactions, all the way through with Breaking Bad actors, writers, producers, crew, etc. It seemed like I was in a different world. You'll see some of this during this talk. I'll point it out. Their vocabulary was different. For example, one time I used the word precursor in talking with them about, you know, using a precursor in the synthesis for meth. And Vince stopped me and he said, precursor? What does precursor mean? And then if you'll notice, suddenly they started using the word precursor in every other episode. He just fell in love with that word. And he kept using this word precursor, precursor. So they wanted to learn my vocabulary and I had to learn theirs just to be able to communicate with them. The desire to influence the outcome of the work was different. We exclude our opinions. We follow established protocols. The directors get to have dozens of takes of a scene, as many as seems right at the time. You know, they just sort of go by what they feel like. And then permitting the outcome selection, we have to be unbiased and we have to include all data unless they are really outliers as established by a mathematical procedure. But the directors get to look at it and say, yeah, out of these 40 takes, okay, that one's the one I like. And it's just based really on how they feel. And so, you know, for me, that took a little bit of getting used to, but I did. And so the goals and considerations were different also. I'll tell you a little bit about that. There's some stories about that. But I was flexible and adaptable. I learned a lot and I had fun. So here comes their second request. So I remember distinctly when this arrived, like it was about 9 or 10 o'clock at night. And here it is, using the P2P method, how much meth could you synthesize with 30 gallons of methylamine in pounds? And for the longest time, I looked at that and I just laughed. I mean, it was so totally incongruous with everything I had ever done. You know, in our labs, we always use the smallest amount of reactants possible. You know, I looked at that and I thought, 30 gallons? I've never used 30 gallons of anything. And then using the P2P method, I didn't even know what the P2P method was. I had to go look it up. I had always spent so much time avoiding discussing drugs, illegal drug synthesis with people. I had just, you know, put it completely out of my mind. And then also to communicate it to them in pounds. You know, we don't use pounds in calculating anything. But like I said, I was very flexible. And so here's the synthesis. This is the synthesis. And so I, in order to be authentic, I looked up illicit syntheses that were being used at that time. And I found they all had the same steps, except back there in the reduction step at the very bottom, which reagent to use. And so I contacted them and I said, well, you know, are you going to want me to calculate how much, that's their question, how much, you know, the yield, do you want me to calculate this pretty rigorously, you know, or do you just want sort of a wild guess? And they said, well, we would like it, you know, to be somewhat accurate anyway. And I said, then I'm going to need to know, which reagent do you want to use? And they said, well, we don't know, you know, which reagents are there. And so I sent them a list of the reagents. I gave them a list of possible reduction methods, and I asked them which to use. Catalytic hydrogenation over palladium, catalytic hydrogenation over platinum, catalytic hydrogenation over cupric oxide, sodium borohydride, metallic sodium and alcohol, sodium cyanoborohydride, or aluminum mercury. And they looked at that and they said, use the aluminum mercury. It's easy to say. And I looked at that and I thought, you know, I have used a lot of criteria for selecting reagents in my career. You know, costs, percent yield of the product, percent purity of the product, safety. But this is the first time I have ever selected a reagent based on how easy it is to speak its name. But I was determined to get along with them. And so I said, okay, no problem. And so if you have ever wondered how that aluminum mercury was selected as their reagent, this is the story. It's the true story. My thoughts were, why are they specifying 30 gallons of precursor? You'll find out in the following clip. Walt and Jesse try to steal 1 gallon of methylamine, but they find only 30 gallon drums in the storage shed. They use thermite to break into the locked storage room to steal the methylamine needed for the synthesize. Why are they using thermite? So, science in the show is bigger than life often, or spectacular. It often outshines the actors. The science is often so strong that it seems to be a separate character. I asked Vince on a set visit if he had done this intentionally, and he just smiled and said, yes. So let me tell you what you're going to see in the next clip. So those of you who are Breaking Bad fans might remember this. So it's at night. Everything is dark. Walt and Jesse have gone all dressed in black. They're going to break into this storage shed. So you can't see them very well. And behind them is just black because it's at night. And so then Walt ignites the thermite and suddenly sparks shine across the screen. The sparks from the thermite obscure everything behind them. So this is what I mean. It takes over the show. It outshines the actors. It seems to be a separate character.
Jesus.
Where are the gallon jugs?
God!
What?
Let's just take this. Come on.
Come on! Jeez!
So, yeah, so, back to their question. How much meth will 30 gallons make? So I had to calculate it. A 30-gallon drum of methylamine is a solution of only 40% methylamine in water. I needed the percent yield of the reaction using the reduction method, the Breaking Bad writers selected. Although aluminum mercury was easy to say, information about it was obscure. However, in 1964, reduction with aluminum mercury was patented in Germany for commercial production of methamphetamine in 70% yield. Now, this was written in German, okay, because it's from 1964. And so as I was going through that and translating it, I was thinking, thank you, UT Austin, for forcing me to learn scientific German. So now this is the first time I've used it. So it did finally come in handy.
Yeah.
So, and we have to assume that Walt, he's supposed to have a PhD from Caltech, can achieve the same yield as reported in that literature. So here's the answer. 40% of 30 gallons of methylamine is 45.4 liters, and that's 30 kilograms, which is 967 moles. And you assume, like I said, that Walt has this excellent lab technique and can reproduce that. 70% yield, that gives 677 moles of meth. 101 kilograms, that's 223 pounds of meth. And I told them that half will be wasted. Only 50% is active in the human body, and they didn't care about that. So, you know, I was wondering, well, why are they wanting to know this? Are they going to want to know if it'll fit in a shoebox? Are they going to want to know if one person can lift it and put it in the back of a car? Why are they wanting to know this? And it turns out that although a lot of effort went into getting this accurately, there was not a lot of use given to it in the show. And I might say also that I did all of this within about 48 hours because I knew that their writers were very talented. And if I didn't get it back to them fast, that they would sit there and say, well, we're not going to wait on this dingy chemist. You know, we're going to ride around that. And so I wanted to get the information back to them. And so I did. However, the impact of the calculation on the show was not that great. But the attention to detail is typical of the effort put into having accurate science throughout Breaking Bad. There were two clips that I could locate. The first is the following clip. Walt used the value 223 pounds to calculate that he wouldn't need to cook for the foreseeable future.
Keep the temperature steady at 425 degrees. We'll need to run it 2 more hours to have enough to make 4.5 pounds.
4.5? Not 4?
2 pounds pace, 2 go back. 4.5 pounds puts us $44,000 ahead, each.
Right on, man. Right on.
With the amount of methylamine that we got last night, we can make 4.5 pounds a week for, well, for the foreseeable future.
How long is that gonna be? I mean, in your situation, how much cash do you need?
More.
The second an impact of the calculation on the show. The DEA agent Hank anticipated the effect of a large amount of meth upon the drug community in the following very short clip. He says, 30 gallons of precursor, there's that word again, that big a score, they're going to wind up stepping on some toes.
Tell you, 30 gallons of precursor, that big a score, they're going to wind up stepping on some toes.
So there it was. So then they contacted me and said, would you like to do a cameo in the show? And I said, sure. And they said, would you like to be a nursing home attendant? And I said, a promotion. And so I said, sure. And so I got there. It was supposed to air on the 25th of September, 2011, but it was cut, but it's still in the deleted scenes. If you buy the CD, you can still see it in the deleted scenes. And so there I am in my little nursing home garb. You know, this is the one that had the guy with the bell, you know, the dinging bell. He played his bell so many times. That's that nursing home. And I asked them, you'll notice that I have like no makeup on. I asked them, I said, you know, I certainly wasn't complaining, but I said, do I need to go anyplace for makeup? And they said, no, honey, the only makeup that we do are cuts and bruises and tattoos. And so I didn't want any of those. So here is.
What was that all about? Huh? Look, I know that guy. What was the point of this? What's it got to do with you?
He murdered someone very close to me.
See you next week?
Yes. Next week.
And you can see the bruises all over his face. So that was my little cameo. So here I am in the super lab with Moira. She was the assistant producer, and with Vince, who was the producer. And this was down, you know, in the super lab. And notice Vince's facial hair. You know, at first, when I first met him, he had no facial hair. And then suddenly he started growing facial hair. And surprisingly, it was the exact same style as Walt was wearing. And I remarked about that to Moira. And I said, you know, he's got facial hair now. And she said, yeah, look around. Look at all the men. And all of the men, you know, handling the props, you know, all of the men, you know, the directors, producers, all of the, you know, everybody associated with that show, all of the men had the same facial hair. They had all grown the same facial hair that Walt had. And I said, what is it? And she said, we think it's a guy thing. And I thought, well, of course, you know, women don't grow facial hair. It's going to be a guy thing, you know. But that didn't help understand it. But it was interesting to see that. And so here it is, you know, here's with Aaron Paul. And you can still see the bruises on his face there. So then the, you know, I was real good friends with Nancy Jackson. And so I mentioned to Nancy Jackson that at an ACS meeting that was coming up in Anaheim, it might be possible to get some people to come over from Hollywood because Hollywood is so close to Anaheim. Mm-hmm. And they might be willing to give talks there and we wouldn't have to pay any travel expenses or anything. And she said, oh, that'd be fabulous. Do you think you could do it? And I said, well, I can try. And so this came from the presidential symposium. And that was in Anaheim. And you can see there it had Moira and Kathleen and Felter from House MD and Jamie Paglia from Eureka and Kevin Grazier from Zula Patrol and Battlestar Galactica. And then me. And then it had Sidney Perkowitz and Mark Gripe, who do a lot of writing and writing books, etc. And so, you know, we had a pretty successful panel discussion. And the room was set up initially for 500 chairs. That filled up instantly. They brought in another 500 and that filled up instantly. And we had students standing and sitting, you know, down below this this table that you see where the panelists were seated. And then people standing all around the walls. And the American Chemical Society staff told me, we've never had anything like this. This is the biggest outturn we've ever had for a symposium at that time. And so it worked really well. That's Maura speaking in both places. And so then they asked me, can you do it again for the next ACS meeting, which was in Denver? And I said, well, you know, Denver's a little farther away from Hollywood. I don't know if I can do it, but I'll try. And so Nancy kept saying, oh, get somebody from CSI. I love CSI, 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 CSI. So I tried really hard and I got Corrine Marinan and Aaron Thomas, both who were writers for CSI. And then Jane Espenson did Battlestar Galactica and Buffy the Vampire Slayer, et cetera. And then I spoke again at that. And so that turned out to be just as successful, even though it was in Denver, but we could only get three, you know, writers. But we were so thrilled to be able to get those. I mean, I thought it was miraculous that we were able to do this again, you know, in Denver. And so then we wrote, you know, an anthology where a lot of people contributed. This was the ACS Symposium Series 1139, you know, named Hollywood Chemistry. You know, when science met entertainment, sort of like when Harry met Sally, you know, that's what they told me anyway. You know, and I was saying, I don't care. I don't care. And so here I am on the another set visit between Bryan Cranston and Aaron Paul. And do you notice the house in the background? That is one of those Vominos pest houses that they were fumigating. And so you can see the covers up on the windows. And so that, you know, that was an exciting thing for me. You'll notice, I don't know if you can see my cursor or not, but do you see this little emblem on my shirt here? So I was an Oklahoma State Bureau of Investigation community consultant, and they gave me this shirt. It says OSBI up there in that insignia. And I thought it would be a real good joke to wear that in on this set visit. And you know, every time I walked into a room, people would just sort of like part and say, oh yes, ma'am, you can walk through here. You know, they thought that I was really there like investigating or something. People were so nice to me. I thought it was hilarious. So the impact that that shirt had. So one more scene, the great power of chemistry and chemists demonstrated in the following scene. And this is actually one of my favorite scenes because, you know, I realized that I might not be able to send Vince and the other people many messages because, you know, I was just a science advisor. And so I would not have much control over the show. And so I decided early on that I would probably be lucky to get one message across. What did I want that message to be? And so I decided that I wanted the message to be that the general public does not appreciate chemistry and chemists enough, that we do so much for the general public and they are not aware of it. Mm-hmm. And so I would give people my little spiel. I would say, you know, we have given them the fabrics that they wear, you know, the carpeting, the paint on the walls, all of their fabulous car parts and their computer parts. And I would go on and on and on in the list about what all chemistry had done and chemists who had brought all of that. And I thought, you know, if I can convince them so that they will be a little nicer to us and appreciate us. And so in this, the following scene, I think that Vince finally did it. And when he did this in this way, with this tone of voice, it actually made me feel good. Hmm. And if you are Breaking Bad fans, you might recognize the scene. It's actually a scene from the episode Box Cutter. And if you are a Breaking Bad fan, you will know what that means. Okay. It demonstrates the importance of knowing chemistry and respect for chemists who know it. It is scientifically credible. It uses science to create drama. It presents to the public several high-level topics from chemistry. It creates curiosity in viewers about the dialogue. They might try to learn about and understand the chemistry.
Think again. You know, whatever it is you're planning there, whatever it is, the point that you're trying to make here, let me suggest that you keep one thing in mind. Without us, without Jesse and myself, you have no one to make your product. Certainly not him. This person doesn't know what the hell he's doing.
Been watching him for weeks. Know every step to his cook.
Oh! Do you really? You... Really? Oh, so please, tell me. Catalytic hydrogenation, is it protic or aprotic? Because I forget. And if our reduction is not stereospecific, then how can our product be enantiomerically pure? I mean, is one phenyl, one hydroxy, two methylaminopropane, containing, of course, chiral centers at carbons number 1 and 2 on the propane chain, then reduction to methamphetamine eliminates which chiral center is it again? Because I forgot. Come on, help me out, professor.
And so those of you who are fans, you know what happens next. I cut it off here so we don't have to see, the blood. So anyway, when I read the pages of the script that had those words and, you know, used my minimalistic approach, you know, correcting it, I did not know the power that was going to be present in the tone of his voice. And if you just read those words, it doesn't come across as powerful as when he is saying, without us, you'll have nothing. And I thought, hallelujah, you know, he finally got it. And so it made me feel really great to hear those words. So additional advising opportunities. Sometimes I'm asked, you know, have you ever had anything else come up as a result of this? And some of them are, I was one of David Saltzberg's Geek of the Week scientist visitors on the set of Big Bang Theory. And they have asked me a couple of times some chemistry questions. But, you know, David Saltzberg is a physicist at UCLA. And then also, you know, one of the stars of Big Bang Theory is a neurobiologist. And so they've got a lot of scientific knowledge already. And when he started having these scientist visitors, he would have them on like every other week. And the cast nicknamed his visitors Geek of the Week. And so I proudly put that on my resume. Yes. I was very happy. And so I've consulted with Oklahoma's law enforcement community to get designer drugs declared illegal in Oklahoma, some of them, and supporting prosecution needed to accomplish this. And so, I mean, I would write like, you know, an opinion which would be used. I did actually go testify, and I was declared an expert in the court. And so I do have that on my resume as well. But usually just, you know, my writing the opinion was enough. And so I didn't have to actually go up here. And so this is sort of like reality following fiction here. Mm-hmm. And then also Triangle, which is a musical stage production by Thomas Meiser and Curtis Moore, was first done in Oklahoma City in March of 2014. And I was on the board of that company up there that did this, that did the musical stage production. And so they asked me if I could come down and talk to some of their cast, because most of their cast members had never met a scientist. So I went down and they put me on a stool and they all sat around me in a semicircle and asked me questions. It was sort of like deja vu, you know. Again, they asked me things like, what makes a person become a scientist? How does a scientist talk to people? How does a scientist talk to other students? You know, things like this. So it was more of the same. And at the end of that, the woman who was supposed to be the biochemistry professor came up and said, I'm the biochemistry professor and I'm going to build my character around you. And I didn't know what that meant. I just said, okay. And so then when I went to the production, when I went to see the show, I went with a friend and she came out on stage and he turned to me and he said, it's you. And I said, it does. It looks just like me. You know, she had picked up my hand mannerisms and my voice intonation and the way I walked and the way I stood and everything. And she, you know, these people really are talented to be able to copy all those mannerisms. And, and we don't even know it, you know. Characteristics for innovation and success, which influenced me to step up to Breaking Bad, as well as most other important projects I have undertaken. First, this is advice to students. That's the way I think of it. Dream big. If you shoot for the moon, you might hit Mount Everest. Second, be persistent. Don't give up. Don't let others discourage you. Three, be ready. Be able to recognize a great opportunity and seize it. You know, on one of my set visits, I asked Vince, that Chemical and Engineering News issue went out to 168,000 chemists. How many volunteers did you get? And he said, one. So that's what I mean. Recognize a great opportunity and seize it, which is what I did. And four, this is actually a quote from Steve Jobs. He said, look for the gaps. It's from the Lost interview. He said, select items that people need, which are significant, which are possible, and which are affordable. And if you'll think about it, everything he ever created fit those four criteria. So I've probably run over, and so let me just say thank you to Vince Gilligan, University of Oklahoma, ACS, NIH, which funded that initial trip out there. I was on an NIH grant to go visit UC San Diego. And then thank you to all of you for being a fabulous audience. And if you have any questions, let me know.
All right. Thank you very much.
My pleasure.
Thanks. Yes. So, questions. I'm pretty sure a lot of you have questions. Jasmarie, do you have any questions now? Any questions, anybody? You know, we did have Mark Gripe years ago too. He talked to us, he gave a seminar to us. I might be able to pull up his topic somewhere, but yeah, that name definitely sounded familiar. One question that I would have is, you know, have you seen over the years now, since you've been in Breaking Bad and, you know, consulting with them and all of that, have you seen more of an interest from Hollywood? Has this sparked a greater interest in Hollywood in trying to make their stories more accurate, have more science advisors, that sort of thing?
Well, there's always been an interest in that. Mm-hmm. And you know, there is this science and entertainment exchange. Mm-hmm. And I've heard them speak many times and I've tried to interact with them. And I know that they say, oh yeah, just send us your information, you know, we'll get you hooked in. But from what I see, they don't ever do it. they hook you in if you are out there and really, you know, living right around UCLA where they're located. I mean, I've tried a lot of things with them. You know, I would say, if you'll just let me know, you know, I'll be able to fly out. But they can never give you notice more than like 1 week in advance. And that's not really enough time to plan a trip. And they don't want to involve people remotely. And so, you know, those things just don't work out. There's still a lot of need, I think, a lot of need. The other thing is, when I first started working with Breaking Bad, some of the people, and I don't even remember who they were, but they said that there was a rumor, belief in Hollywood that you can't have a hit show if you have a science advisor. And I said, what? And they said, yeah, they said, because that science advisor is going to be in there saying, you can't do that. And it'll just totally stifle the creativity. And when I heard that, I thought, wow, you know, I want to make this a big success. And so I tried as hard as I could to get along. And whenever they said, we want to do this, I'd say, absolutely, you know, let's make it happen. There was one time, though, that Vince and I did disagree, and that was when he asked me, what do you think about making the meth blue? And I said, I wouldn't do it. And he said, why not? And I said, because meth is white. And he said, well, what if it's pure? And I said, then it'll be white. And he said, well, what if it's really, really, really pure? And I said, then it'll be really, really, really white. You know, and as you know, he totally ignored me.
Yep, you know, he sure did.
I never complained because it was his plot device.
Mm-hmm.
It was Walt's trademark, and they had to have it in order to be a success. And that was their most important thing. Their most important goal was to be a success and get picked up the next season.
Right.
And so
right.
You don't want to stand in front of that, you know. So I didn't, you know, like fuss over them too much about these things. I just tried to enable what they wanted to do.
Yeah. So the minimalist approach really did pay off.
Oh yeah, they really liked it. We did not argue but you see, they knew I was a scientist and I had knowledge of the science, mm-hmm. and I knew that they were writers, mm-hmm. and they had to make a hit. They knew how to make a hit show, mm-hmm. and I did. So I respected that and they respected me, mm-hmm. and we got along fine.
Mm-hmm. Okay, anybody else has questions? So I have, Alvin, did you have a question? You guys could unmute yourselves.
I would say, Professor Nelson, I voted for you and I've never met you in person.
But well, thank you. Yes, I appreciate that.
Yes, because I know Professor Etchengoen quite well, and Professor Gray is one of my mentors from the time I was an undergrad in Jamaica with Prof. Das Gupta. And I'm really enthralled when you have ladies and females showing the youngsters that science is fun. And I was wondering though, how do you do it? How do you do it? Because I would like to learn how you, Harry Gray, I mean, have this flair, to be honest. How do you guys do it?
How do we do what? Be honest?
I mean, you know, not only the honest, but sure the flair. I mean, where you remind me of Prof. That's good, where you guys like know the chemistry and like you guys are like walking white chalk. And you guys just disseminate it quite well.
How do we know how to disseminate things? Well, I'll tell you the absolute truth, what I really think. And that is that, you know, I have Native American background.
I figured I was going to ask you that. I could see it.
Yeah. And I'm from Oklahoma. Anyone who can trace their roots back in Oklahoma, you know, several generations have Native American background.
Hmm.
And so I noticed that when I first came to OU as an undergraduate, I noticed I was different. I thought differently, you know. And I'll tell you, you know, that you, if you have a different way of looking at things, and you're going to if you have a different background, if you have a different way of looking at things, it makes you really creative.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you can survive getting through the majority institution, because the institution is going to be run by majority faculty, you know. And so you have to really learn how to accommodate everybody and get along, just like with the Breaking Bad people, you know.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And then keep your creativity, not lose your creativity, lose that difference, and recognize that difference, that creativity, is a huge asset. It enables you to see gaps, just like Steve Jobs was saying. Oh, yeah. It enables you to see gaps that other people don't.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I meant when I said, you know, the other people, you know, would try to discourage me. They'd say, oh, that's no good. And so, you know, the first time I ever made a teaching device, and I showed it to the people I worked with, and they said, that's worthless, that's no good. And so I submitted it. I thought, well, you know, I think it's good. I think it's creative. And so I submitted it to three different publishers because I thought, you know, if I submit it to three different publishers for 7 weeks, I had heard you had to submit it to about 20 publishers to get one publisher to want to publish it. And so I submitted it to three different publishers. And within a week, they got back with me. All three of them wanted to publish it.
Wow.
And if I had listened to those people telling me, yeah, that's worthless, that's no good. See, but I had confidence in myself that I could see something that they couldn't. And so that's, I think I this is a good message for minority students, I think. Because I think that the minority students don't realize that their differences are going to be so important. It can make them be very creative chemists or whatever they want to be. It can make them very creative because they see opportunities other people won't.
Yeah.
I agree with you because I saw an article exactly what you said in Inside Higher Ed. And I remember when it was the only bitch, and I'm from Barbados.
I could hear it.
And I was in Jamaica. Prof. Das could say, do you know that you're a totally different Bajan from the other Bajans? And wherever I go, people tell me I'm different. I mean, you smile on a Monday morning, you smile on a Friday, and why you're so different? But I can see something because I know we who came from, ancestors came from Africa and the Native Americans, we share the same values and the same struggle. And I can see you. And you can see that Sunday just one or two, and you can see that, you know, you remind me of me. I saw that instantly, to be honest.
Well, thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Other questions?
Where's Zoe? Where's Miss Gentles? Is she there?
Is Zoe here? I told Zoe about how our conversation yesterday.
Yes. I told her father too.
Yeah. So if there are no other questions, we want to go ahead. Oh, I have one question. It's a sort of curiosity thing, and I put it on the poster. How come you were advertised in Times Square?
Oh, I was on a speaking engagement in New York City.
Okay.
And they put it up there. You know,
okay.
It doesn't cost much. You know, you just have to know how to do it. And so you can get it up there. Yeah.
Oh, wow. Okay. Yeah, I don't know of any other chemist that has been in Times Square.
Yeah.
I agree.
On the
interesting,
what they call the super cam or what, I forgot what they call it.
I see. Okay.
So it just happened. You have to recognize those opportunities and seize them.
I know. I'm really glad for some of those pointers and insights you gave as well about being persistent. And those are some really important attributes for chemists. They are also very marketable. It's not just for chemistry, in life.
Right, absolutely.
Yeah. Yep.
Well, thank you so much. I'm gonna have to run, but I really appreciate it. I'm so happy I finally got to meet you.
Before you go, I'd like to introduce our chair, David Randall. He has some closing remarks and thoughts.
And thank you very much, Professor Nelson. That was a really interesting talk. So this is the end of our chemistry seminar series for the whole year. And so you've capped off a year when we've done all sorts of different topics. We had Dr. Murray arranges talks from all sorts of different people. And so that we've had, I don't know what, 15 or 16 all remote over the course of the year, maybe even more. So we've started out with people talking about Dr. Tour from Rice University, kind of talking about issues in chemistry and origins. We've had three different speakers talking about coronavirus and you know, solutions and people's perspectives on that, including Dr. Corbett from the NIH, and then one of our alumni, Roger Pack, who is working at Pfizer and helping out with their efforts. We had someone telling us about the chemistry, analytical chemistry, and some archaeological artifacts. And so it's really been a great chemistry seminar series, and I'm grateful to Dr. Murray for arranging that, and grateful for you for giving us, you know, telling us other ways that, that chemistry can influence our popular culture. And so I'm grateful to you for reaching out to the producers of the show and inserting chemistry into that. So,
well, thank you for having me.
Thank you so much.
All right.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Thank you again.
Okay, we'll see ya. Thank you.